Hi, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Too Opinionated, where today I'm joined by actress Justina Adorno. So welcome, Justina.
Thank you.
I'm so happy to have you on. I'm such a fan of yours. You're so busy.
I want to be more busy. I'm glad you think so. I feel like I do better mentally when I'm like, doom, 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 doom. So the past couple of days I've been super busy. And I'm loving it. I'm like, please.
Well, you have no time to worry. You just do.
What?
you don't have any time to worry if you're busy. You just do.
Exactly. Yeah.
So that's not too bad. So I usually start here. Tell us a little bit about what made you want to get into the entertainment business and how you got into the business.
Well, I loved talking. I loved storytelling, and I feel like I'm so proud of like little Justina, because I always knew like I want to do something that I'm good at. What am I good at? What do I like? I want to be happy doing whatever I'm doing. I don't want to feel like what I'm doing for work is making me miserable, because I'm going to be doing that predominantly.
That's right.
You know what I mean? So I kind of tapped in, like, knowing that, like, I loved performing. Like, whenever I was in Catholic school, I loved doing the readings on Fridays. Anytime there was a school production, I was, like, the most excited, for it. And everybody else, like, would roll their eyes. And I'd be like, yes, this is the best time of the year, I get my family used to always be like, oh, you're a little actress. And I was like, I am, And as I got older, I started to realize I could do this, actually. Oh, wait, you can actually be an actor if you decide to. And in middle school, I remember my sixth grade year, I was in a leadership program, and they had asked us to draw a adult-sized version of ourselves doing our dream job. And okay. I decided actress.
Well, so what did it look like when you drew that? What were you doing?
I know I had like a purse, and I think it had like a star on it or something. Cause I mean, that's what I thought.
Cause you're a big star.
Right. Something symbolic. And like, I remember the word perseverance was like the word that we like learned. And I was like, that's what you need to be an actor. Because I remember people would say like, oh, well, if you want to be an actress, like that's one in a million chances. And I used to always be like, well, I'm freaking one in a million. There's a lot of people in this world. Why can't I be one in a million? And I just always followed my heart. Like I always consumed my time with like the drama department or like doing a production in school. And I auditioned for a boarding art school and studied acting. Yeah. And I was just like, let me just keep continuing this investment. I'm a firm believer in, if you give 100% of your focus and time and energy to something, there's going to be progress. And so I decided to focus on acting because it made me happy.
Yeah. That's awesome. So did you do theater throughout school?
Yeah, I did. It was funny because my first 2 years of middle school, the drama classes were booked up, but then half the class never wanted to be in the course. And I used to be like, I used to pick this as my number one elective. Why am I not getting the class? And, but I did it in eighth grade, and my eighth grade drama teacher was like, you are really good. And I really believed her because I felt like she saw something in me.
Yeah.
And then I went to a magnet program in my first high school, and my teacher there too, she was like, Justina, you're really good. I think you can really do this if you want to. And I just always had teachers in my life, awesome. especially the women.
Yeah.
They would tell me like, Justina, I think you can really do this. And by the time I was in college, I had one of my acting teachers tell me, I think if it's going to be anybody, it's going to be you. And you're going to actually have a tough time deciding what it is you want to do, not not if you can do it.
Right. That's pretty great. Picking
projects. Yeah. So
have,
have you stayed in touch with any of the teachers? I do. Yeah. My middle school teacher, I still keep in touch with her for sure. The other ones aren't on social media, but my middle school teacher, she's on social media and we're always in contact. Monica White.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. I love hearing about teachers that kind of inspire their students.
I was really lucky. They were always super supportive. Monica White, Donna Wilson, and Monica Bell. Those were the three that were like huge, huge, huge. And Gwendolyn Schwinkie, she was a new addition to my college, but she right away was like,
yeah,
you got something. And I was like,
good job, teachers.
Thank you.
You went to Coastal Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So Myrtle Beach is, you know, the preferred vacation destination for all West Virginians.
Yeah, Coastal Carolina had the rep for being a party school when I went there.
Well, so did it have it before you went there? That's the question.
It was definitely like that before I went there, when I went there, and I'm pretty sure after I went there. I'm not 100% sure, but I definitely was always in like the English building, the Edwards building, which is where the drama department was. I didn't really venture out too much after my first semester of college.
Yeah. I think it'd be difficult to be a college at a beach and not be a little bit of a party school.
Right. It was actually an escape. It was really nice. I really appreciated that. Like I could like go to the beach if I was having a hard time.
Yeah.
And just like have that peace and like that moment to tap into nature.
Yeah. Yeah. You can't beat the ocean for just relaxation, you know.
No.
Getting in contact with something larger than yourself, that type of thing.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty great. So what was your first paying acting job?
My first paid acting job, my middle school drama teacher actually recommended it for me. It was right before I went to college, like my senior year of high school, going into my freshman year of college. It was an underage drinking commercial to encourage kids not to drink and drive. And so I was one of the girls that was like, I drive better drunk because I'm worried about the cops. That was my line. It was so much fun. I was like, wow, this is pretty cool.
Yeah. I mean, that's pretty great to get your feet wet a little bit.
Yeah. I was like, okay. Because learning how to act on stage is so important, but the technicalities of doing it on camera is so different. Right. And I still haven't taken like an acting class for the camera. I've taken some on camera casting directing workshops, but not like a course.
Yeah.
It's hard. It's be tricky.
Acting is not an easy profession. A lot of people think it is. It's not.
Yeah. A lot of people have some skill.
I know. Cause they think, it's not that easy.
Yeah. Like to be like what's happening now, like people like, you know, all these influencers or whatever, they're pretty much being themselves, playing around with their friends. And that's difficult too. That's like a whole other beast. I'm like, that takes a lot of commitment, you know what I mean? And creativity. But to jump into someone else's shoes and jump into a whole new world with other people's words, and it takes another type of craft. But I always tell people, if you're in tune with who you are, and you know yourself, and you can be vulnerable, I think you could be a good actor.
Yeah. Yeah. Agreed. Yeah, for sure. It just
takes that commitment. But not everybody wants to be vulnerable.
No, nobody wants to be vulnerable. That's if everybody was vulnerable though, I don't know. Maybe we, you know, there wouldn't be very many acting jobs out there.
And maybe we'd be like on a whole other level of like amazingness in this world.
We so would. We can make it happen.
You're making my Southern come out of me. You're like, we so would. I'm like, we sure would.
Yeah, see, I didn't even realize I had an accent until I started speaking with people on this podcast, and they're like, you got an accent. I'm done. Yeah. Like, you got an accent, buddy.
Totally do. You're from West Virginia. Come on.
Yeah, it's pretty thick. Although it gets thicker if I'm speaking with people from here.
Yeah. That's how I am. When I speak to my family that's from South Carolina or that lives in South Carolina, like, I could feel it coming out again. And then whenever I'm talking to people from New York, I, like, jump back to there. It's so interesting. It's so funny.
Yeah, because you were, like, you were New York when you were there, right? It was, like, the Bronx.
Yeah, I'm from the Bronx. I live here now, too. I'm from the Bronx, but I lived in South Carolina from 11 to 22.
Yeah, that's. I think that's such an interesting dynamic because you've got country and city both.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. I can't really tell it though. I'm not picking it up with
which one.
With either one, it just sounds normal to me. Of course, I may be comparing it to me. So
there you go.
You don't have much of an accent compared to what I have.
For sure. For sure. Yeah.
Did I see you, and I'll admit, this isn't a show that I watched, but my wife watched. She watched this show called Sweet Bitter, and I swear you were buying a car on there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw that one.
Yeah, well, that was the only part I was in. I did, that was one of my first, under five, like, guest star roles that I was just there for, like, a minute. You know, but it was so much fun. It was, you know, like, just to be on set. Like, anytime I'm on set, I've done background work, everything you name it, I've done with acting, just because I just love being on set.
Yeah.
You know, even if the focus doesn't have to be on me, as long as I'm watching other people act, as long as I'm
learning,
hearing the director, I just love the environment.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. What was your favorite background set that you were on?
My favorite background set? Let's see. Dang, I can't remember.
Because that's a little bit different world. You know, if you're doing background work, that's different from actually acting on the show. You know, it's kind of, you're there.
It's so different.
But it's like a whole different world, a whole different group of people.
Completely different group of people. And they treat you differently too.
Yeah.
They treat you completely differently. Dang, I can't remember what the show was called. It got canceled within the first season. But I remember there was, like, a ballroom and we had to dress up all fancy. It was so much fun. And I learned a lot of the technical aspects and, like, the terminology.
Yeah.
That they use on set. So I found that very helpful. And whenever I got to be a series regular, I appreciated the background so much more and made sure that, like, I, you know, connected with them and, like, thanked them for being there. Like, you know, spending all these hours in high heels and
it's a thankless job.
Huh?
It's a thankless job, background work.
It's a thankless job. And you know what? They create the world. If we were having our scene and nobody was at the restaurant, it would be so weird. So I say thank you to everybody who's a part of every production. Background is everything.
Yeah. So you get to... You've got, like, the entire acting range because you're on, like, two different shows right now, which is really neat. So I've been watching you on Roswell,
which
I love you on Roswell. And there's a third season coming out, I think, maybe this summer.
There's a third season coming out. I'm not on the third season.
We need to have you on there. That was going to be my question, was whether or not you're back for the third season.
No, I'm not. I thought I was going to be, but I think COVID and everything kind of, like, made things a little difficult. I'm not a resident there in New Mexico.
Yeah.
And technically,
your character, though, still there, right? I mean, it's Nothing has happened to you.
There's a possibility.
There's a possibility. That's right. You could come back. It's up to us fans to demand it.
I've had a few fans ask me. They're like, "Are you coming back? Is Steph coming back? We want a deeper storyline."
Yeah,
but that's sometimes like tricky with big casts.
It is. Yeah, we like Steph.
She's cool. She's a cool chick.
Yeah, we thought you were so good. And I was skeptical coming in because I really liked the Roswell show from the 90s. So I was like, I don't know. I don't know if I want to watch, you know, another one. But it's really good. It's really good.
Yeah. Yeah, the cast there is amazing. They're so sweet. They're so cool. And, oh, Santa Fe is beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You can't beat Santa Fe. Mm-mm. I mean, if you got to hang out and act, might as well be in Santa Fe.
Exactly.
So you are on season 3 of Mayans, right?
Yes.
Yeah, and that one just started back up. Like, well, I guess it's been 6 weeks, 2 months, something like that ago. Started in March.
Yeah,
I
think but it started the season finale is this Tuesday.
I know, it happens so fast.
There's only 10 episodes. Like, now shows have, like, 10 episodes or 8 episodes, which I don't really like, but that's just our culture now, so.
Well, it's good and bad because, like, it used to be, like, when I was growing up, you'd get like 26 episodes, but half of them they'd just be filler. You know, they wouldn't really advance the story. So you get a more concise story now, but they're so short, you know, and then you're stuck with so many empty weeks without the shows that you love.
I know. I think 12 or 13 is a good number.
Yeah. Yeah. We need 10's not enough.
They need to get their shit together. but that was a different role.
I mean, that for you, that was a little different role. And you've got like the coolest name on TV.
Nails. I know. I remember when I was reading for, I was like, Nails? The ship Crazy Nails or something? Like,
it's the best.
I was like, do I have to get crazy nails? And they were like, oh, it's like tough as nails. And I was like, oh, tough as nails. Cool. And she is pretty tough.
She's pretty tough.
She keeps it together.
She's tough. And she hasn't had it easy on there.
She hasn't. She really hasn't. She's been keeping it together. I mean, she's pretty open too, you know?
Yeah.
Pretty open person, but overall she's been keeping it together emotionally.
Yeah. Yeah. I love that character, and it's so, I don't know, it's different from what I've seen you do before. You know, she's pretty tough.
Yeah, I like her. I think she's pretty cool. I'm excited to see what season 4 can bring for her. You know, she got herself in a love triangle.
I know, you've got this big mess going on.
Unintentional. The fans are like, "You did Hank dirty," and I'm like, "She didn't do anything." Hank was trying to be her friend, and she was like, oh, "Thanks for being a friend." You know, like, what do you do if you have a baby coming and you're supposed to just deny the father and secretly, like, have this other guy raise your baby? That's more drama.
That's not right.
That's putting Hank in a more dangerous situation because they're in the same crew.
Yeah, that's not right for Hank.
That's even more horrible to do to him.
But are you engaged now on the show, right?
Now she's engaged, and I'm hopeful that maybe this baby brings some joy into the show and brings some.
It's a dark show.
It's a dark show.
Yeah. We need some joy.
We need some joy. And I'm hoping that maybe this baby can do that for the Reyes family.
Yeah.
And just, I don't know, turn things around for at least a second. You know? I know things are going to go down, but like, come on.
Well, that's right. Are you going to, is season 4, is your character going to be like a softer character because you have a baby? Or will you be like more fierce because you have a baby?
I don't know. I have no idea. That is honest truth. I have no idea.
Yeah. I think we're going to have that episode where you're like in full mother mode where you have to protect the baby. You know it's going to happen.
It's going to happen.
It's going to happen.
I'm hoping that, you know, we get to show both sides of males.
Yeah.
The softer side and like why she is called nails.
We need to know why she's called nails.
Tough as nails.
Well, that's but we what definitely they say.
We need something more concrete. I agree with you.
Yeah, we need an origin story.
Exactly.
Yeah. But see, I think it should be something completely out of left field. It should have whatever everybody thinks it is, that should not be why she's called nails.
Exactly. I agree. I mean, write to Debbie, right? Write to our writer.
Yeah. It needs to be something weird. You know, when she was younger, she collected nails or something. It needs to be just
they're like, oh, tough as nails. She's like, no, I have an obsession with nails.
Yeah, I've got a nail collection.
So I kill people and keep their nails. That's a plot twist. She's a psycho.
Yeah, she's nuts.
But like, nails are nuts, actually.
That seems like that show, it has the best outfits and costumes. It has to be kind of fun, you know, the way they dress you up in that, because it's, I don't know, everybody looks cool in it.
Yeah, I was so comfortable. I loved our costume designer. He was always like, what do you think, pants, tank top? And I was like, yeah. And he was like, perfect. And I was like, this is great, because like now I'm like super comfortable. I feel like a real person. Like, yeah. I fit perfectly into this world. And yeah, the guys always look badass too. Like,
yeah,
the guys look so badass.
Yeah, they look tough.
They all look good in their costumes.
Yeah, that's not too bad. Have you got to act some with Edward James Olmos?
No, wait one second. I need to grab my charger.
Yeah, yeah, grab your charger. I will fill the space.
With Edward. I didn't get to work with Edward. My world is predominantly in the bar, but I'm hoping with this baby I get to.
Yeah, you need a scene with him.
I grew up watching him. I remember when I told my mom I was going to be on the show, she was like, oh, Edward's on the show. You get to work with him. And I'm like, relax. This is a big cast. I don't know if I'm actually going to work with him. But I saw him on a Zoom call when we did a table reading once, and he's so nice.
Yeah.
He is so nice. He was saying hi to every single person, like asking everybody how their day was. Just a sweetie pie.
Yeah, he's amazing. He's amazing. Everything he's in is good.
Right. He's a legend for sure.
Yeah, he really is. So is it difficult being on a show that's a spinoff from a successful show? I mean, is that more pressure, or do you guys kind of just treat it as your own thing?
I feel like everyone's pretty much treating it as its own thing.
Yeah.
And as of right now, it seems like Mayans is doing a pretty great job standing on its own.
Yeah.
You know, our
show is kind of a loose spinoff.
Huh?
It's kind of a loose spinoff. It's not a,
it is a loose,
I mean,
spin-off.
It's got a tie, but it's, I mean, if it wasn't a spinoff and it was just a show, wouldn't affect it at all. Still be just as
good. Yeah. I mean, some of the guys from Sons of Anarchy come in on a couple of episodes, which is really, really cool. But our showrunner has got such a vision. I feel like Sons of Anarchy has just inspired it, obviously, because it's a spinoff. But because it's so legendary, we, you know, obviously want to live up to the same type of hype. And I mean, we got a season 4, so that says something, right?
That's pretty awesome. I know that a friend of ours is Ron Perlman, who was on Sons of Anarchy, and he loves the new show. The last time I talked to him, he said he loves it. He thinks it's really well done. You can't get better than Ron Perlman liking it. Yeah, it's so well written, and it's just, you know, it keeps you guessing a little bit, you know, and you have some cliffhangers.
You've got good characters. It keeps you freaking out, that's for sure. You're like, oh my God, what the heck is happening?
Yeah, and it's got a cult following. You know, it's got like a cult following.
It does.
Yeah.
Which is really cool.
It is cool.
Like, have you got to do... We tweet every time an episode's out, we tweet with the fans, and the fans are so invested.
Yeah, they're so into it. You probably haven't done it yet because of COVID, but have you got to do any of the shows, or do you plan on doing some shows in the future, you know, where you can interact with the fans?
I hope so. I hope that happens soon. I miss that part. Like having events and meet and greets and all that stuff. I think that's a whole part of, you know, the artistry too, that we get to have in film and TV, even like on Broadway, you know, after they do a show, they go out, they sign autographs, they talk to the fans.
I know, and you so need
right
that.
Now, like Twitter is that for us right now.
Yeah.
But I miss the in-person stuff. I miss the in-person.
We're going to get it back. It may be end of this year, but it's coming.
Hey, as long as it happens at least for season 4, I'm good.
So my oldest, my daughter, she said, I have to ask you about Grand Hotel, because she was such a fan of that one. Yeah. And she said she just loved your character on that, because she's, you know, it was kind of soap opery, you know, but more like a nighttime soap.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, she loved it. But she wanted to know if you got a chance to work at all with Eva.
I did. I was with Eva a lot of the time. Like, she and I got really close, and she's given me so much advice, and she's such a great director. I think she directed like 2 or 3 of the episodes, but she was always there. Like, she was there from when she was pregnant with her baby all the way until she was bringing him on set, and I was playing with him, and it was crazy. Like, I loved Grand Hotel. It was a dream come true. I was very, very sad, along with the rest of the cast, when we didn't get picked up. Like, we had such a great, great bond, and it was a magical show. It really
was a good cast. How many seasons did it have?
1.
Yeah, I was thinking it was 2, but that's so strange, because it seemed like it was popular, had a good cast. I mean, Eva Longoria, I don't get it. I don't understand the decision making.
I don't understand.
Who do I need to call?
I'm angry. I'm still upset. That was such a fun show. But I am grateful because, you know, one, it allowed, you know, my biggest dream to come true, and it opened so many doors. And, you know, I'm grateful that I was able to jump into all these different characters ever since, you know, the cancellation, because, you know, the last thing I want is to be stuck as one person.
You know what I mean?
That's always been my fear. I'm like, as much as it's secure, and it's easy and comfortable to be on a show for like 6 seasons, I want to be able to jump in and like tackle so many different genres, so many different storylines, you know? So who knows?
What's the genre that you haven't done yet that you really want to do?
Well, I really want to just do film. I really want to do like some independent film, some dark, raw, powerful shit.
Sounds pretty good to me.
What was that?
I said, let's make it happen.
Like, fingers crossed, you know, like, I've been doing a lot of auditioning, but yeah, I really want to do an independent film.
Are you talking drama?
For the most part, but I'm so open to comedy. Like, I haven't done comedy. I'm sometimes scared of comedy.
I think you'd be really good at comedy.
I started off my acting with comedy. Like, everything I did in like high school was comedy.
Yeah, I think you'd be really good at it. You would also be really good on one of the superhero shows, which would not be bad.
I would love that.
You've already been on the CW. They've got like 10 different superhero shows.
I had auditioned for Batwoman. Or Batgirl, and I auditioned for Aquaman too.
Ooh.
But slowly but surely, I'm figuring it out.
We got to come up with like either a supervillain.
I need to be on your background.
Yeah, we got to get you on here.
Once I'm in my superhero show, I make that face.
God. Yeah, Yeah. You have to. We got to get you on here. There's
a new goal now. That's a new goal now.
You'd be really good on Batwoman. That'd be really good. You could be maybe a villain.
I'd love to play a villain.
Yeah, that would be pretty cool.
Fun. Yeah, screw the freaking protagonist.
No, yeah.
I'm going to be the mean, scary. Yeah.
It's more fun.
It is so much more fun. So much more fun.
You can just go, you know, be out there. I always said if I was ever on a superhero movie or show or a science fiction show or movie, I would live off of that for my entire life. That's all I'd need. I'd just retire after that role and just go around and do shows, you know, and sign autographs.
I feel you.
Yeah.
That's all you really do need. Cause then there may be the sequel and then
an Adam West role, you know, if you play Batman, you're Batman forever.
Exactly. It's so freaking cool. That is really cool. Who knows? Maybe that's in the future. You're putting it out there for me. So
putting it out there. I think you'd be you could do Batgirl. They haven't done they've got Batwoman, but they need a Batgirl.
Well, I think CW is doing a TV show.
Of Batgirl? They've got Batwoman. Maybe so.
I can't remember.
You can totally do
Batwoman.
Maybe it is Batwoman. Yeah, there's a Batwoman show.
Maybe they'll just create a whole new one.
Yeah, you could do it. You know what else you could do is the Titans.
Mm.
The Titans show. You could fit right in on that. Don't worry, I've got you covered. I'm gonna get that. I'm gonna make this happen.
Help me out. Help me out.
I'm gonna make some phone calls. We gotta get you on.
Okay. This. Okay. I'm ready. I'm ready. Let's do this.
So I was reading that you're animal activist. So what does that mean? Does that just mean that you're kind to animals? You know, what does that mean to be an animal activist?
That's a really great question.
That's what I do.
I believe it's advocating for them, obviously, right?
Yes.
I'm advocating for their rights. Anytime there is animal cruelty news that's brought to my attention, I post about it. I educate people. I start to educate myself on it. I've rescued stray kittens that have been hurt and have found them homes and have reached out to nonprofits that actually help do that. I make sure that my hair and makeup products on set are vegan and cruelty free. And I am vegan. I live a vegan lifestyle. I buy only vegan brands now.
Yeah.
Only vegan shoes. I don't use any product clothing that exploits animals anymore. And I spread the awareness as much as I possibly can.
That's so great. Were you always vegan or did you become vegan at one time?
No, I was not vegan. I it's crazy. Like when I look back on my life, there's so many moments, just like with acting, it's crazy. Like my memories, my most profound memories are revolved around acting and animals. Yeah. I always knew like those were the two things that I was super passionate about. And I always felt like I had to pick one. And then it came to me that like, wow, I could do both. And actually, I feel like my purpose is mainly to be an advocate for them, to be an animal activist. I feel like that's my superpower. I just feel like I'm not living my truth if I don't speak up for them. And it was about like, I was 15 when I saw a video about, you know, farming.
Right.
And farming factories. And I remember being completely devastated, 100% feeling guilty.
Right.
I was just like, wow, like I always knew this was messed up, but like seeing it was different. And I was really disturbed. And I went home and I was crying and like telling my mom, I'm not eating animals anymore. And at that point, I didn't even know what vegan was. I just knew vegetarian or like pescatarian.
Right.
And, but I would still secretly eat it, you know? And I started to feel shame and guilt even more. And I just like developed a really, really toxic relationship with food because I was doing something I knew was wrong, but I couldn't quit this addiction to food. And yeah. I couldn't really separate it, even though I knew it was almost as if like the information was still hitting a wall. And I would go like a year being vegetarian, and then I would go back home for Thanksgiving and I'd have all the pressure, all the voices of my family, right. No one's watching, it's okay, it's only one day, and I would cave in. And it wasn't until about like 3.5 years ago, maybe four, I can't even remember anymore, where I was like, this has got to stop. Yeah. And I saw a visual of farm animals on one side and a human and a dog and a cat on another side with forks and knives. And I was like, oh my God, I'm doing that. I'm putting more value on a cat and a dog than I do with a pig and a cow, you know? And other countries, they eat cats and dogs and we right. shame them, but we're doing the same thing. Other countries, they find cows and pigs to be sacred and we eat them here. And I was like, it's because we act like one is better than the other. And that's what we do as humans too. We're like, oh, this person looks like this, they're less than, you right. know, and this person looks like this, so they're better than me. And it, or they, whatever the case may be. And I was like, whoa, this is complete corruption. We're all equal. Nobody wants to die. That's the pig, right. This person from this place, from this culture, from with this sexual orientation, like we all want to survive.
That's right.
And I just felt like nobody was speaking up for the animals, and the animals can't rally, the animals can't sign that's petitions, right. they can't get their communities together and fight for themselves. And so I was like, I need to start taking action and being a leader in something that I claim to be so passionate about. And I just said no more. And so as soon as I started my acting career, like it was more serious and I started to get a platform, I decided to also dedicate my life to bring awareness to animal rights and awareness to how much we exploit the animals.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's so great and commendable, because a lot of people watch those videos and they feel bad when they watch them, but it's a whole another thing to actually change your lifestyle to make a difference. And then it's another thing on top of that to actually be an advocate, you know?
Yeah. It's hard. It's really hard. And I let people know that it's not like an overnight thing. It's something that a little seed popped into my head when I was 15 and I was still battling and struggling and saying, I love animals, but I was still going with my father to go get chicken wings at the spot that we always go to, you know what I mean? And,
yeah.
you know, I started to just be like, wow, I need to be a woman of my word.
Yeah.
I need to really do that, because if I don't want other people to be cruel to animals, I have to set an example and say, look, if I could do it, you can too.
You can
do it. It's a process. It's a journey. You know, it's reminding yourself, this is not beef. This is a cow. This is a cow's dead body. The dead body was tortured. It had a child, or it is a baby. You know, like I started to just break down the truth. And it's so uncomfortable when you say it like that. You know,
yeah,
when
you're really
like,
is.
I'm eating a dead body. You're kind of like, what? I'm not even going to go there. Like what? But like the more and more you say it, the more and more insane you feel.
Yeah.
And I was just like, okay, I can't do this to my kind. I can't do this to my people. I need to tell people what the heck we're doing here. It's kind of crazy. And it's like, it's not like we're out in the wild looking for food and we're like, ah, it's like, no, we've evolved. We have so much food. There's so many options. And now it's 2021. There's like oat milk, cashew milk, cashew cheese and like Beyond Meat Impossible.
Oh yeah, burger. You can almost fake it now.
Yeah, the options are abundant, yeah. You know, and so I'm just kind of like, hey, everybody, you can do this.
Well, how has
you can.
How has your family taken this harder stance that you've, you know, how's Thanksgiving now?
Well, you know, I had to skip a couple of Thanksgivings in the beginning of my veganism. I was like, you know what, let me cook my own vegan Thanksgiving for myself.
Yeah.
And I promise you, that was probably my favorite Thanksgiving. I was by myself I made my whole dinner. And I was like, look, this is freaking possible, you know? And my family supports me now. Now they're like, wait, is this vegan? Like my extended, my cousins and my aunts.
Yeah.
I'm like, yes, it's vegan. I made it. I'm eating it. You know? And they'll look at my vegetables. They're like, what is that? I'm like, you know what cauliflower is. Like, you know,
right.
Like, there's nothing foreign about vegan foods. They're all, except for the meat, the mock meats, you know,
right.
It's vegetables and grains and legumes and fruit and everything that we actually grew up eating, you know, except it's guilt free. And, you know, whenever I'm around my family, my mom and my brother, my sister, they eat vegan because I'll cook for them. And like my father, like in order to get bond with me, he's gone on his whole little journey. He's not fully vegan yet, but he is very much plant-based. He's lost over like 60 pounds because he's more along the lines of like herbs, like so he'll do a lot of juices and like holistic things. And I'm like, I'm proud of you. Like
that's awesome.
It's a journey. It's like a stepping stones, but you just always have to be reminded of why you're doing it.
Yeah.
And why you should.
I think that's so great, so commendable with that. So when you first switched over to vegan, did it give you more energy or less energy?
I mean, okay, I'll put it like this. Whenever you're cutting anything out of your life, anything, whether that be alcohol, a person, literally anything, you're going to have some sort of withdrawal. There's going to be some sort of like fogginess, funkiness. And like your mind is like, no, I still want this. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's always going to, that's for the most part normal, but you have to get over that period. Even like when you go to the gym, you're like, I'm going to get in shape. The first month is, or even first two, three months are so difficult to stay committed, to stay on the right mindset, to give it 100%. But there's also a turning point where you're like, oh, this is easier. But now I get why I'm doing it. Now I'm reminded of the good aspects. And the beginning of me transitioning to veganism was a little difficult because I was like, oh my God, the thought of not having it,
right?
Or, you know, of change was, and if I'm able to do this, kept on going into my mind. But then, like I said, like, I was like, wait, this is the dead body. This is the dead body. I don't want that. What am I talking about? You know, and what the heck am I talking about? And I slowly started to lose that. And I'm not gonna lie to you. I never thought I'd be in the place where I didn't crave pizza, like a cheese pizza, a non-vegan pizza, or crave wings, you know, but I don't, absolutely not. And I am a foodie, let me tell you. I love to eat. I could go to like restaurant after restaurant, like one of my closest friends, they call it food tour. I just restaurant after restaurant after restaurant. But I do that with vegan foods now, and vegan foods are amazing. Like the best chefs will tell you, if you can cook vegetables, you are a chef.
Yeah.
You know, so I feel like the food quality has just elevated whenever I go out and I go to a vegan restaurant. You just have to go to, like, if you want pizza, you got to go to a vegan pizza spot.
Right.
You know, if you want Italian food, go to a more Italian specialized vegan spot. you know, you don't go to a Chinese restaurant looking for a good burger, right? You don't do that. So it's the same thing with vegan foods.
Yeah, you just got nowhere to go.
Huh?
You just got nowhere to go. Yeah.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Well, and I love the fact that you've actually moved that to, you know, non-food products, because I never would have thought of that. You know, that never would have occurred to me to worry about makeup or you know, soap or whatever you're using.
Yeah.
Because a lot of that does have, you know, animal products in it.
Exactly. It's crazy. I was talking to a couple of little girls and they were like, what? Yeah, isn't that crazy? I was like, there are still things to this day that I'm like, how is this not vegan? You know, I'm like, it's insane. And we're not taught that. And we have just been so accustomed to not question things and to not read things and to not research. We're just like, sure, yes, sure. What's cool? What's advertised? And it's like, it's important if we want to make sure that our kids, the future, has a fighting chance, you know, to question things, to know how it's made, to understand what you're putting on your body and in your body. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
If we want a true healthy lifestyle. I mean, it's given me mental clarity too, going vegan.
Yeah, I'm sure it has. I'm celiac, so I don't do wheat. And
that's amazing.
Yeah, and it's been, I don't know, a couple decades now. But when I first had to make that switch, really difficult. But the further I got away from eating things that were bad for me, you know, the more clarity, the more focus, the better I felt, all of that. Mm-hmm. And now I don't miss it, you know.
Exactly.
When I was first giving stuff up, especially like pizza, that type of stuff, mm-hmm. it was just killing me. You know, I cheat, you know, mm-hmm. you think, well, I'll just have a little bit and stuff. But then, you know, you eventually get tired of feeling bad. You kind of adjust and it does. I think that's the best part about eating healthy is just the mental clarity that you get, because you get rid of all the fogginess that you don't even realize you have.
Exactly. See, you get it. That's the exact same process that you went through with that is the exact same process that happens when you go vegan. And I commend you for that, because it's insane. Like, people think that you have to have like a major gluten allergy to stop eating gluten, but gluten is just not good for you at all, which is why now I'm in a place where, you know, all these mock meats that have gluten in them, they've helped me along my journey, but now I don't even buy that anymore.
Yeah, you can start eliminating
that. Yeah, because I'm like, okay, I don't even crave that anymore. That was also a part of the addiction. Like, now I'm like, I want to eat whole foods. I want mushrooms for my meat substitute. And, you know, I'm now like finding a whole new love and obsession with juicing. You know, I would have never thought that. Never.
It's
ever.
The further you get into that type of lifestyle, the more you realize that there's so many things in our food and our products that are just filler. You know, it's just cheap filler that they're putting in there, and we don't need it. It's not healthy.
We don't. It's crazy. Yeah. It's so crazy sometimes when I'm like, wow, how do we get here? I'm like, how did we get here? We started focusing on the wrong things, or we just stopped questioning, you know. We went to what was convenient and easy and right there, as opposed to going, no, I'm going to shop locally, or I'm going to make this myself, and I'm going to pick out my ingredient. I'm going to go to the farmer's market. Like, all those things started slowly being a rarity and like a privilege to go to. And it's like, what? That's where we started from. Now that's like triple the cost, and now you can't even find that. It's insane. And I have faith that if we all get out of the mindset of everyone's not going to go vegan, everyone's not going to recycle, everyone, it's like, okay, well, we're not supposed to be worried about everyone.
That's right.
We're supposed to worry about ourselves and what we do That's what right. We teach the people that we love and that are around us and influence them. And then that chain reaction happens. If we're so worried about everybody else, we're not taking care of ourselves. We're not being the leader that our communities, our families need.
Yeah. Yeah. That's so true. Well, Justina, this has been the best. Thank you so much for taking a little bit of time with me. I love talking about kind of the healthy eating and vegan because I don't think we do enough of that. You know, you always hear about it. So-and-so is vegan or so-and-so is, you know, watching what they eat and stuff, but we never really talk about it. And I think that's a big reason why a lot of people are kind of scared of it because they don't understand. You know, they're too scared to try it. It's different. They're just too scared to try it. So I love that you're doing that. Before I let you go, is there anything else that you have upcoming that we haven't talked about that we can kind of keep an eye out for you in?
No, just right now you could catch up on Mayan season 3 on Hulu, and our finale is on Tuesday. And the next thing that most likely for certain is season 4, and right now I'm auditioning, but the next thing I get, I'm gonna be hitting you up and letting you know about it.
Oh my gosh, you have to come back. You have to come back when so we can talk some more. I got a feeling it's probably going to be either a superhero or supervillain. I just have a feeling. That's probably
I'm serious. And if I do, I better get on that background.
Oh, you're on it. Yeah.
Okay.
Whatever you get, we're putting you on there. Okay. You can choose who you want to replace.
Oh, I don't want to replace anybody. I just want like a little
squeeze you in there.
Exactly. We'll
just squeeze you in there.
Yeah. Next to Arnold. Next to Ooh. Arnold and Sylvester.
Yeah. Yeah, that's perfect. Yeah, that's exactly where you need to be. Yeah, okay, we're going to make it happen. Justina, where can we find you on social media?
You can find me on Instagram at justina.justina, and I also have a separate vegan page. It's at Justina Vegan Journey, just in a vegan journey. And my Twitter is Justina Adorno.
Oh, very nice. Very nice. Don't you think you need to write a book about this journey?
I want to.
You should.
I want to. I kind of started it, and I need to stop talking down on the writer in me, because I'm like, oh, I'm not a writer. It's very time consuming, but I really do. I think it's important to share the ups and downs, and I thank you so much for conversing with me and being enthusiastic about it and open-minded. It's amazing. I love it.
No, we have to, at some point, either in Carolina, South Carolina, or in New York, we're going out for a vegan meal. We're going to do it.
Oh, I'm going to hold you to it.
Has to be gluten-free, too, though.
Easy. I got you.
What's the main course in a vegan Thanksgiving?
Ooh. I want to say, for me, it's the sweet potato casserole.
Okay, I'm in. All right, you got
sweet potato casserole, green bean casserole, stuffing. But stuffing, I gotta make sure if that's gluten free.
You can do gluten free stuffing. You just have to.
We can make
gluten free bread.
That's easy. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. We can do it. I'm in.
It's easy.
We got. You have me a sweet potato.
No brainer. The sweet potato casserole I make is fire.
All right, Justina, hold on a second. I'm going to hit pause. All right, so that was Justina Adorno. I get the best guests on here. I'm so blessed that I get to talk to so many talented rising stars. And she is just the tip of the iceberg right now in her career. She is absolutely going to be big. I can't wait. She's such a talented actress. So thrilled to speak with her. I hope you enjoyed my particular brand of nonsense. She was tolerant and terrific. That was fun. Thank you guys so much for tuning in again this week. Really appreciate that. If you haven't done so, help us out by going to YouTube, MeisterCon Pod, and subscribing. We'd really appreciate that. You can check out our website, MeisterCon.com, where we've got, I think now about 250 episodes, audio and video on there. And just absolutely, I mean, if you go down through the list, you will not believe the guests that that we've been lucky enough to have on the show. Just established stars, up and coming stars, musicians, just the best people. So please check that out. There's a blog from Brett that is funny and well written and just awesome. I know you'll enjoy that, and you can look at all the other great things that we have going on. So please check that out, MeisterCon.com. Until next time. Bye, everybody.